I want to thank the Beauchaux family for their generous contribution and for everybody to make it here today. I will jump straight to the technical stuff before I get overly sentimental. So as Philippe mentioned, the context of the prize is actually perfectly aligned with some of the core research interests that I've been investigating. This will be covered in much more detail by our plenary speaker, Mr. Bart Busmans, but I do already want to give you a bit of context about the African energy challenges, because it motivates the specific topics that were proposed for the Beauchaux grant, so that you can draw the link between the two. So, African needs for energy are actually quite different from what we typically encounter in, for example, US or European markets. One remarkable aspect is the energy access gap in Africa. Currently, more than 600 million Africans do not enjoy access to energy. And if we're gonna meet the needs of the continent for 2030, we need to build up 600 gigawatts of capacity. And the current plans for build up are only up to 220 gigawatts. So you see that there is currently a serious energy access problem, but this will persist for years to come. And one approach towards overcoming this energy access gap is renewable resources. So there's a number of international initiatives that are underway for closing this gap. Mr. Busmans will actually is much better place to talk about these in detail. I want to focus on a specific one, which is called the African Renewable Energy Initiative. So this is an initiative that was ratified by a number of international partners, Japan, the European Union, Canada, in December of 2015. And the goal here is to collect more than 10 billion euro from 2015 to 2020 with a dual purpose. The first is to ensure affordable access to energy resources for all Africans. And the second point is to achieve a leap jump from limited access to energy to abundant access to distributed renewable resources. And here I'm highlighting the notion of leapfrogging in the sense exactly that Philippe described earlier. So he very well anticipated what I wanted to bring up here. And the analogy to the telecommunications revolution is evident. So the deployment of the African Renewable Energy Initiative is planned to take place in two phases. The first phase is more modest. So the goal is to build up 10 gigawatts of renewable capacity by 2020. And then in the decade from 2020 to 2030, the goal is to build another 300 gigawatts of renewable, thereby delivering a decisive blow on the energy access gap needs. This might be overly ambitious, but there's no question about it that renewable integration is an important issue for the continent in the years to come. So, furthermore, I'm providing this slide in order to demonstrate that there are specific examples of things that are already happening. So I have here two examples from Burkina Faso and from Senegal. So Burkina Faso just energized a big solar park back in September, which is intended to cover 4% of the country's national needs. And the country has very aggressive renewable integration targets. So the goal is to cover up to 30% of national consumption up to the year of 2030. And similarly, in Senegal, there's a number of utility scale solar projects that are already underway. And the goal is to cover 20% of the national needs. Well, the goal was already to cover 20% of the national needs from renewables last year. So this brings me, so the conclusion of this short motivation is that renewables are becoming a very important component of the energy transition in Africa. And this motivates the agenda that was proposed to the Beauchaux Family Prize, which is in line with some of the activity that's going on in my group. So what was proposed in the project were two topics that are related to real case studies that we've already been exposed to in Africa, and one broader, philosophical, so to speak, topic about how to organize distributed systems, which is also based on a broader research agenda that's going on in my group. Before I talk about the three themes in detail, which in a nutshell, the first topic is how to manage storage in the presence of significant solar uncertainty. The second topic is how to plan transmission systems to integrate renewables. And the third topic is this broader topic of organizing distributed systems. I would like to thank the couple of people who introduced me to this area of applications. In particular, there have been very valuable collaborations with colleagues from Tractable. We've been working quite a bit with Pierre Henault, Leonardo Ries, and Nils Lemput, who proposed these two topics to us in the context of master theses. One of the topics was further addressed in the doctoral work of Yuting Mu. And I'm very proud to be working with master's students who have graduated from our program and have occupied positions in very prestigious universities internationally. So Julian Weiss, Damian Schur, and Leopold Cambier have contributed to this work as well. And ongoing work with Taku Kaneda, Bruno Lasso, and Guillaume Nimal have also contributed to these topics. So, jumping into the specific themes, the first one, which is was inspired by a case study in Burkina Faso, is how we manage storage. So here, the specific idiosyncratic features of Burkina Faso, which make it quite different from a typical power system that you might encounter, is there's a significant net load, negative net load during the day, which means that there's a case to be made about large-scale storage. The country has very expensive domestic thermal production, and they rely to a significant extent on imports, actually imports being cheaper than domestic thermal production. And the question becomes, how do we optimally manage storage if we have a very large-scale deployment of solar power? And this is a classical situation of decision-making under uncertainty, where we're trying to balance between a very expensive but overly conservative approach and a very a potentially cheap but risky approach. In particular, the dilemma here is while we're getting a lot of sun during the day and our batteries are charging from the negative net load, should we also resort to imports while there's tons of sun coming in? And there's a case to be made that you might not want to do this because you just want to count on the sun charging your batteries and then you discharge your batteries through the night. But if you didn't get enough sun during the day, it might turn out that the batteries run dry somewhere in the middle of the night, and then you have to import, but the lines that you're importing can't carry enough capacity to cover your full energy demand, and then you have to turn on your expensive domestic thermal. And the alternative, which is more conservative, is to decide to also charge on top of the sun with imports during the day. So this is a classical setup for an algorithm that we know to work very well for a very similar problem, which is, however, solved in a different timescale, which is called the stochastic dual dynamic programming algorithm. This is an algorithm that has been effectively deployed for decades now in large hydrothermal systems like Scandinavia, Latin America, Turkey, New Zealand, and a number of other countries. We have a very good theoretical understanding of its performance, and we were able to demonstrate that for the Burkina Faso context, this is an approach that makes sense, and these were results that were published recently in the IEEE Power Systems Computation Conference. There's also, for those of you who are working in optimization under uncertainty, Damian Schur and Leopold Cambier, who I mentioned earlier, have developed an open source MATLAB toolbox for doing optimization under uncertainty, and the Burkina Faso problem has been provided as open source code in the link over here. That's the first topic that we're now digging in deeper in the context of the third theme that I will discuss later. The second topic, again, inspired by interactions with Tractable, was the planning of transmission, the greenfield planning of transmission. Now, another interesting feature about African systems, there's a lot of potential for expanding them. Expansion planning is a classically difficult problem for power systems planning because of its combinatorial nature. There's just too many combinations of things that you might want to do. And you've got to worry about quite a few things at the same time. On the one hand, you've got to make sure that you correctly account for the physics of the flow of power. You've got to make sure that even if the way you build the network, even if components fail, you can still serve demand. And also, when you're planning for 20 or 30 years down the line, there's a lot of uncertainty about what the future demand will be in different locations. So it's quite a challenging problem, in fact. On top of that, you're stuck with these decisions for 30 to 40 years once you make them, and they're quite expensive decisions. These are challenging and important problems, and the approach that we're investigating with Pierre Henault in ongoing work in the context of Guillaume Nimal's master thesis is to take a two-step approach to tackle the problem. What you're seeing in the left there is the map of Burundi. The blue dots are consumption centers in Burundi, and the red dots, which I'm having a hard time pointing at from this angle, but that, I think that's a red dot, those are supply nodes. And the idea is to connect the blue dots with the red dots, to do this in a way that is N-1 reliable. So our approach to tackling the problem so far has been to, if you try and throw the whole thing at a commercial solver, it's just too many combinations of things to consider, so it's hopeless. Instead, we're dividing and conquering the problem through a clustering method, and then within a smaller group, so here's, for example, one group that we might want to attack. Still, if you want to tackle this with a commercial solver and N-1 contingencies, it's too heavy to solve. But if you attack it using Bender's decomposition, which is a technique that breaks the problem into two pieces. So what it does is it has a first step where you're deciding on investment on lines, and a second step where it's checking if these the way you've built the network is actually feasible. This turns out to be performing quite well for the Burundi case study, so we're digging deeper in that direction. The third topic is a more a broader point of view of how to organize systems that are based on distributed resources. And here the interest is in particular in the challenges that are presented by distribution low voltage systems. So if you think of how I should operate a power system from top to bottom, including the distribution network, the moment you introduce the distribution network into the picture, things become very hard because the physics that we use to describe flow of power in distribution networks, using linear approximations of these physics, which are acceptable for high voltage grids, are no longer accurate. So we need to worry about reactive power, we need to worry about voltage limits and real power losses. And on top of that, there's just too many things that you need to worry about when you're looking at a distribution node. A typical city, for example, might have hundreds of thousands or millions of control points, as opposed to a transmission network where you only need to worry about 1,000 or 2,000 things, and that can be handled by commercial solvers. So the idea is to exploit the fact that I don't know if you've seen these pictures of the coast of England. You look at it from 10,000 miles, and then you zoom in from 1,000 miles, and it looks identical. And you zoom in 1 mile, and it looks identical. So it's actually self-similar. No matter how deep you go, it's always the same thing. And the strategy for this larger scale research project is to combine recent innovations that have been made in convex relaxations of power flows with our knowledge in stochastic programming to zoom really deep in, solve that bottom level problem, and take the solution and bring it one level up and repeat the same game over and over to come up with a decisive way to organize power systems in the future. There's more information in these links and a couple of conference and journal papers that already present African case studies. With that, I'll conclude the part where I discuss my proposal. I apologize, I have an English version because my French is not adequate for the event. So with that, it's my great pleasure to introduce Mr. Bart Busmans, who's the Chief Operating and Technology Officer at NG Africa. He obtained his PhD in the Department of Mechanical Engineering at KU Leuven and is the former managing director of Laboralec and a visiting professor at KU Leuven. I'm especially grateful to Mr. Busmans because he made himself available on short notice. So the floor is yours, and we look forward to an interesting presentation.